Adra?
Ja.
Litt mye? I kropp? Ja. Men tom. Tom? Det var fint.
Det som det
Yeah.
Okay, nice to be here. Thank you for the invitation and for the opportunity to talk a bit about my work. I don't know if I'm going to speak so precisely about plays. I will come on it because I started actually as director, but I turned to become more and more choreographer. So I'm still working with the actors on text. I mean, the National Theatre, maybe some of you saw pieces that I did there. But I would say that my basic occupation right now is more the question of the body in the space and the question of the movement in relation to the body, in relation to the space. And from this, the question, of course, how to use texts. I've been every time interested in relation between text and body, more from a perspective that the text actually is a kind, for me, a foreign element, that the actor is not so much playing a role, he's not so much embodying a character, but more practicing a text, and through the practice of the text, the question of the embodiment appears. I think something which is very important to me in all this talk of especially right now, this school is maybe a good example for this. I would say that the postmodern wave of the deconstruction wave went through Norway too. And and I feel it when I read the book about the school, that all the authors which are part of this are there and the theory is there. But I'm a little bad about it that we should not forget actually the question of the embodiment of that. The danger maybe sometimes that is becoming a lot of thoughts that you can show, that you can present, but how to stage these thoughts. And here the body is an important element, is how to be in the body by being in relation with these questions. And it's interesting, just as a little introduction or commentary, that more or less all the names which are in this book about the famous directors, Bob Wilson, Max Stewart, Tim Hatcher, all of these people, they all have a traditional education. All of them. Max Stewart studied dance, on a very modern dance, completely traditional. For example, Jérôme Bell is ballet dancer. Boris Charmat is ballet dancer from the Paris Opera. So why these people, or what happens when these people who has a traditional experience, more or less what you try to think differently, they have an experience from the traditional perspective and they think from there on it. When you don't have this experience, the danger with just thinking about these things without having experienced the traditional way is that actually you don't know what you deconstruct. So you can think of it, but it's another perspective to know by having experienced it, by having danced in a traditional way, by having played in a traditional way, to feel yourself, something politically here is a problem. And you find a position. Your nose somehow is having a weight. But the danger is, and I'm not talking just about here, I feel it in Berlin, I teach in many universities, and that the people suddenly don't even know why they should not perform like this. Why they should not embody a character. So it's becoming another ideology, which is as much ideological than the traditional ideology of Ibsen's way of acting. Just wanted to put this as a little situation, be careful with that, that what you are being taught, even if it's from the surface, more the right political way, it's an ideology too. Okay? Now we come a bit to the, and it's, we cannot think outside of an ideology. So it's not a critique to it, it's more, when I speak now, I am ideological already. When I use words, it's automatically something manipulating, it's automatically something constructing. We cannot think out of this, it's just to be aware of it makes that we can find other strategies. So I've been working a lot of text, but since 2007, I work with the more with the dancers or more with the question of the body, and I would like to focus a bit on an experience that of what I'm working now more in the last 2 years through an experience that I had in Paris, and it's not true, but it's suddenly, let's say that I had a question already before, and this experience crystallized a little bit. The question of, it was in Paris, I was in the evening in the Attentat in Paris on November 2015. And then suddenly we were in the city, we could not go out, it was you can imagine, crisis everywhere, especially because we had that the attentators were in different places at the same time. So we didn't know really where it is. It's not as if we had just one place which was located, and you could say, okay, we don't go there. It could be there, it could be there. The announcement from the police was, all stay at home, don't go out. I was in a theater this evening. We were not allowed to leave the theater until 1 o'clock in the morning. And then we went out, and they said, no, you can go. But it could have come from everywhere, this. And the first time I experienced something that you've been said a lot, that right now in the world, we don't have any perspective anymore. We don't have any front anymore. We don't know where the enemy anymore is. There is not West and East. There is not somehow a kind of dialectical way to look at history. And so it's theory, this. But suddenly with this body in Paris on this evening, I really didn't know where to look. And I realized that my gaze, which would give me one direction to say, oh, here is the danger, was not operating anymore. Because the danger was not here, the danger was there, was there, was there. So So I felt suddenly very limited, actually, with the way I organize my body normally through the gaze. And it is what, as human being, we are all doing, that the eyes, the seeing, is what is giving you a perspective in the world. That's the difference from maybe the rest of the nature, of the animals, that through the standing up or in relation with the eyes, the human beings open a perspective to the future, a perspective to thinking, a perspective to planning, organizing, and to security, to organize its world, to anticipate. The eyes is related with anticipation. And the verticality of the human being is automatically related now in us as human beings with watching. So there is something in the dependency between these two acts, the eyes watching, looking in front, and our verticality as human beings, which are related. Freud speaks very nicely about it in the Unbehagen der Kultur, I don't know the name of English, where he speaks about that the human being decided to stand up. I love this sentence. He doesn't say that anthropologically the human being separated himself from the other animals because he stood up. I mean, anthropologists would say we don't know what was first. Did we get this special way to look at the world, to think, because we stood up? Or because we had already this brain and these eyes wanting to anticipate, it brought us to the vertical. We don't know what is first. I mean, it's a typical question, what is a first step? Freud answers, the human being decided to be vertical and to look. I like this because it allows us to question our verticality. And from this I come to a basic question of my research in the last two, 3 years, is the question of the verticality from the human being in relation to the horizontality of the world. So how could we thematize actually this? Because there's one thing that the theater, for me, which is a big question for the theater today, the theater, you are still sitting in the front of your performance. So of course you can still have some situation where you are, the performance is here and people are sitting in different directions. But you are still seeing from one perspective on it. You can still have something, Forsyth did a beautiful piece on this called Endless House, where in the whole building in Frankfurt, we were sitting in different places, like in block, and the dancers were dancing everywhere around us. But still, what I have as I had one direction, and if I wanted to look at the dancer, I had to follow with my gaze, or then I was looking at the other side, so I was still having this front. So it seems that for the theater, this question of the front is essential, and is somehow almost a limitation if you think that now the front is not helping us so much. I mean, there is some theory about this now that the world is changing so much that the way of thinking of the Western traditional philosophy, in it you can put Derrida too, is becoming obsolete, which is something will not allow us anymore to grasp the world. Because thinking, I mean, Jean-Luc Nancy, I was talking with him about it, and Heidegger, I think he told me, wrote about it too, that the philosophy of the Western society and the way of thinking is basically based on the eyes. He was trying to tell me, Jean-Luc, like he could not name a philosopher which is putting himself or his thinking in relation to the hearing, for example. He said, yes, thinking, philosophy is related to watching, seeing, front. So suddenly when the world is becoming so uncontrollable, and you see it now with the elections in America, we see it in France right now, we are in the primary phase before the elections, everything happens but nothing what is predicted. So we are somehow in a time, all this question of terrorism brings all in Europe suddenly a kind of atmosphere from everywhere, it can suddenly explode. So we are in a kind of insecurity constantly, and our way normally to see history as something that we control, that we canalize, that we anticipate the future, is somehow not grappling anymore. Theater is still as an old art, and based on this sitting and watching something in the front of us. And it's coming, of course, from all the 19th century, where we had this kind of imagination that what we see, what we think, is in front of us, and we can observe the world, think the world, manipulate the world, change the world by looking at it, understand it by looking at us. But suddenly it's not just here, it's here, it's here, it's here. It's... So what do I do with my position in theater when I'm still using my brain and my way of thinking by watching to the front? So the question that I would have to the theater, and it's what I try to develop aesthetically, is it possible to question this frontality in theater? It's a huge question of a stage designer in terms of from which perspective are we looking at the stage when we are looking at the stage. Is it possible to make the audience sitting in front of something an experience that what is happening is not in front of them but around them? You understand the questions? So it's a big shift. I'm looking at something in front of me, but I feel that it's not happening just in front of me, it's including me as audience in what is happening. So it's a difference if I said, oh yes, me as audience, I have the world in front of me, I look at, or I am in the world, I am part of the world. So I'm not suddenly as audience in the theater anymore in front of something running that I watch and I have a kind of almost a superiority position. I can watch and you play for me. No, I'm within. I am part of what is happening in it. So it's questioning actually a lot our relation to the position of the human being in the world. I will see the first species, the most intelligent and controlling everything, or are we part of the other species which are everywhere and not just here? So, yes?
Why didn't it happen in the dance performance if you were sitting in the middle and there was one dancer in front of you and dancers behind you? Why wasn't that?
Because I will come on it to talk later. The problem is that if a dancer is standing here, and you are here, sitting and looking at him, if the dancer is still working with the verticality, you don't feel that he has a back. The problem, so you feel yourself that you have something in your back, something here, something here, but you are still not questioning your way of perceiving. You still perceive with your eyes, so you can maybe hear. But as long as you don't shift your relation to the vertical, that's what I'm going to talk about now, you cannot have another experience. And the performer, in order to make you have an experience of the horizontality, you need, the performer has to make this horizontal experience. As long as the performer is still using his eyes as the priority organization system for himself, you, from the identification with the performer, the pure empathy with his way of perceiving, you still use your eyes. So you can have a lot of eyes experiences like this, but you still don't experience another position. It just shows you that you don't have the control anymore, but it doesn't put you within the world. Do you understand? So it has to go through the performer. That's what I want to come on by talking. So what I was actually searching in the last years and developing further is, how is it possible for the performer to have such an experience with his body that he is not using his eyes in the front in order to make me feel as audience that there is another way of being? By looking at him, I will realize that there is another way to be. So it's a kind of identification through the eyes from the audience to a way of being which doesn't use the eyes the same way. You understand? And then it makes you reflect it. That's why actually, in this sense, I'm pretty conventional. I love this traditional set of the theater. I love the cook casting, I love the portal, I love the plush and the red things. And in this constellation, to bring the performer in a way of being which doesn't match at all with the normal space, when you are in a traditional theater, all the architecture is made that you see a picture. I mean, the stage designer knows it better. It's all the lines, everything is organized, that you have the impression you are in front of a picture. And in this experience of the picture, to open a depth. So it's the shift actually from the... if you have two persons in front of each other, and they are looking at each other, it's the shift, I don't know if you can see in perspective, no, this one doing okay. Sorry, I try to. I'm gonna draw first this. When I look at somebody, actually what I create automatically is a wall. Looking at somebody is actually creating a surface in the vertical. And the try is actually to shift the surface down. That when I'm looking at somebody or I'm standing, I'm not having this typical frame. In theater, you call it the fourth wall too, you know. It's what creates a distance. And you have it in life when you look at somebody. When you look at somebody, immediately you create a kind of separation. How can you keep down this wall that it's suddenly the surface on the floor? So from a perspective, when you are standing in front of somebody and you have a wall in between, you try to make an experience of the surface you are standing on, and the two people feel that they are standing on a surface together. So it's the difference if I stand, I feel the surface I am on all around me, and I'm walking on this surface, or if I stand, I see you, I look, and I don't feel the surface I'm on. To feel the surface I'm on, take away, actually, this axe in the front. Am I going too fast?
Yeah.
You ask question in between. I'm too fast?
Yeah.
So ask if you didn't understand something.
Just slowly.
Slowly, okay. So the whole game is to, how is it possible to shift down this frame, this surface which is vertical, to bring it so to the horizontal that you have a feeling of the surface you are on. And this brings you automatically to have a back. Because if I feel the surface I'm on, the surface is continuous all around me. So I feel suddenly my back, or it's calling me, because this surface doesn't stop at my feet. I feel it's going in the back of me. And then you have a kind of equality with the one that you look at. You are like two persons standing on the same surface. So the animal, the object, the chair, the table, the human being, we are all actually having the same surface we are standing on. So I am not suddenly the human being who is watching, able to have a kind of distance and to objectify the what I look at, but I am part of the same world because I share the same surface with them. To feel the surface brings you back actually to feel your weight. So it's just to say, okay, how can I put myself in relation to my weight, to my mass, that we are all falling towards the surface. Ask question if you don't understand now. I see eyes looking at me like, which is good. Ask.
Do you think that to break the fourth wall?
Yes.
It's depend on the performer itself, or the relationship between the architectural space and scenographic.
You have
in
to
a
scenographic
way to connect
to
the auditorium
the
with the...
Yeah, you need to integrate from the space. It's a very different situation to fit the surface. If I have, for example, a stage which is higher and you are sitting in a traditional space, or if I am the same floor. If I'm the same floor as the audience and they are in a tribune, to feel the floor going under the audience and to feel how they are standing with me on this surface, it's easier as a process than to be on a higher surface, to feel the surface so I can feel the frame, but I can still be out of them. So here you have to feel actually the whole architecture of the building you're in. But the thing is, by relating to this surface, you oblige the audience to to look at your band. It's really that they have the impression of depth again. Normally when you look on a stage and you look at an actor, you don't feel depth in the room. You look at the body, you look at the picture that the actor or the dancer is sending to you. You see it very clearly when there is dialogue between two actors. I mean, I know by working with actors how much time it is to get them really acting together or having another relation together. They will be in front of them like this, but the main occupation will be here. There will be this, this, but they are here. And that you say, no, the priority is this axe. And you let this axe being watched. It's very different that to feel my relation to you, the relation to here, and the talk together. So you are shifting some other priority there. But in each space, I mean, when we are on tour with the dance pieces, we have to adapt to each space, actually, the piece. To see, where are the tricks? And it's really to feel how the architecture of this space is organizing my body, is actually organizing the gaze of the audience, and is influencing the way I'm going to be perceived. You all work with this in life. I mean, what I'm talking, actually, it's not just a stage process. When you are talking with somebody, you give a picture of yourself. At the point that you use your eyes in a certain way, you send to the other one an image of you. Because you got this image of this relation to your body through a mirror. By being very little, you stood up, and the first experience you had of yourself as a concretion experience is your image in the mirror. It's what Lacan calls the mirror stadium, the Spiegelstadium or Stade du Miroir, where you exist, you as human person saying, me, I, through an image. Before the image, you don't say me, you don't say I. It's because you looked at yourself in an image that suddenly you see a kind of beautiful unity, organized, it looks very good, and you feel as a child actually normally looking at the world around, everybody's walking, standing, running. As a baby, it's full of frustration. It's, you just want to get this power of unity, and you see it in the mirror, and mama is here, and mama said, yes, it's you. And then you say, me, I. So your identification to get who you are is through an external picture of yourself. So every time when you look at somebody and then you talk, talking is related to it too, you send a picture of yourself. So the question is not to get rid of this, it's part of our humanity, but how can we question, play around, come to a place where this system of sending pictures is a bit, not destroy, you cannot, and it's nice too, but reflected or felt in it. And the relation to the floor, what I call a bit on a more dramatic, pathetical way, the horizontality of the world, to bring us back to this horizontality. This is nothing new, it's being done in fine arts a lot. I don't know if you know works, for example, from Robert Morris, 60s, 70s, he did a beautiful piece. You can look in the internet if you want. It would have been better to show you with the picture now, but I don't like it so much. It took some pieces of felt, and long pieces, and he cut in them some straight lines. So when you are looking at these pieces on the floor, they are still having some very geometrical, recognizable forms. And he put them up, and he just hanged them at the wall at little support there. And they were just falling randomly on the floor. And he exposed this in the museum, and the beauty of this is that you see how the consequence of the weight is just opening these pieces of face on a completely random way, and this is actually, for him, then the kind of creation which is horizontal by being vertical. Because this openness in the face, and it looks very violent when you look at it, it's like a big mass going in all the directions. All this openness is because of the weight of the world bringing them down again. And it's a beautiful experience of vertical, because it put them high, but the way they open in these holes, you see the index of the horizontality when they were on the floor. So you still see, actually, in it, the horizontality of it, their relation to it. You have it with Pollock. You all know this fist painting, Pollock, the American painter. Yes. So painting like this, more or less, he lets drops. What does he do? Is that he is going away from the picture and the vertical way of looking at the world with the eyes when he is painting automatically the picture, and he lets just the weight, the drops of the painting, which is bringing the horizontality in game, and this he put it in the verticality. Which means when you look at the picture of Pollock, where you use your eyes in a traditional way to see an image, it shows us the result of an horizontal work. You have Trisha Brown in the choreographical world, did pieces where the dancers are just lying on the floor and moving on the floor. Pieces choreographed in the vertical is all in the old early works on Trisha Brown. You have a beautiful DVD about this if you want to look. It's called Early Works of Trisha Brown. I think it's pieces from 96 to 97. And you see this, all the work she did in museums, but in theater too, when they are on the floor, on the streets, just lying down and making some choreographical movement, which are thought from a vertical perspective, but she turned down the bodies. And the beauty in this is that you still see actually the organization visually of the movement, but because the body is being turned down, you have a release in the muscles because they don't have to stand. So you see the materiality, the weight of the body, the looseness a bit between the articulation that she will never get if you stand. Because the body which is standing automatically, because of this eyes vertical relation, is having a certain clarity. And when they're on the floor, she keeps the movement, but because of the giving up of the standing, you feel a looseness, a little, the pieces, the articulation start to appear when they do it. So you have a chance to relate to the body more from the perspective of the material, of the creature, of the weight, of the mass. Leib of German, you call this difference between Körper and Leib. I don't know if Norwegian if you have this difference. And which is almost that you connect to your body in his flesh, in his formless, which is more the pure materiality of it and not the... the recognizable picture of it. We have many examples in the history of this. The thing is that when Trisha Brown bring the body back in the vertical in order to dance and to make, and I don't know if you saw pieces of Trisha Brown, she had back the vertical. So all what you had on the floor, what she was having, the looseness in the body, the materiality of the body, exposed to the world, you see when you look at these four women on the floor and they are dancing, you see actually how fragile they are in relation when they stand, in comparison to it. And when you look at this, when they stand back, something goes away. So the question is it possible to stand up from the floor and to keep the fragility that you have on the floor by standing up? That would be the question. So to make it a bit simple now, which makes sure that the human being is putting himself back in relation to the nature, in relation to the world around him, so he is not the priority species who is able to look. You still look, but you are in relation to it. You are in a dialogue with it. You see suddenly that you look. You see the potential superiority that you could have through looking. So you can put yourself in relation to the world, but not by being the one who is seeing, but the one who is in it too, with the others. First question about that, before I go further. Yes?
So not by being the one who is seeing, but by being the one who can see, but I can see.
Yes.
So like that you're having the
potentiality
of it, but not putting
yourself
in the superior.
Exactly. You can still, but you are reflecting the fact that you had this position many years and you built a lot of shit. But you cannot lose it. You cannot, the goal is not back to nature, back to the origin. I'm not saying that we have to go back in the forest and give up our verticality. We cannot. And why? It allows many things which are beautiful. For example, language. But to be aware of this specific position that the gaze gave us, and to reflect this. And this is for me where the theater is becoming an amazing place, because the theater is the place of the gaze. Theater of Greek means looking. And it's hard to bring the people there to face, to feel, to be in relation to this. But it's something very difficult to make experience, because it's so evident, it's so much in us, in all our organization of our body, that it seems like almost impossible to question this. And to be honest, what we do, the dancers now, to go there, I mean, it's more or less 10 years research to really understand the question I'm talking about now. It was not so clear from the beginning.
Yeah, I was just wondering why you talking about the surface. Is it because it's the opposite of the verticality, that it needs to be the horizontal that needs to be explored in order to find the hole in the end? Or like, I'm just wondering why is the surface very two-dimensional and not the space?
Because the by feeling the surface, it gives you the feeling of the back. And it makes you feel, actually, the surface, you feel it first to your weight. If you connect to your weight back, you feel suddenly that this surface is holding you.
Okay.
So you have an experience of the extension, of the continuity of this surface. It is a floor which is becoming a surface.
Okay.
But if you are looking at it in a traditional way, it's not a continuous surface. It's an object that you distance yourself from.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can make the experience if you want. There is a nice experience with this to be done. It's a bit intense, because you shift really your gaze, the way you look down. If you are looking at it from a bit above, you see it, but your head is up. You can see in all the performers, all the dancers, but also actors, when they fall, their head is every time a bit up. And see what you do when you fall on the street in front of people. It's the best situation to experience, actually, the loss of your gaze, to fall. That's why all this work is about falling. But if you fall, the first thing you do, you look. You bring your head up to look, to have a control again. Yes, because what happened when you were falling, you gave up your image. You didn't have any choice. It's not as if you wanted. You were just falling. So suddenly the control of how you look like was away. And the first thing you do, you fall, you look. Immediately. And after you feel, oh, it pains. It hurts. But first is to look, if you can. If you enjoy it too much, you will not. But it's really the reaction. So in order to, that's why it's a difficult work for the performers to do, is that you need to understand yourself as constantly falling. You bring yourself in this experience of the fall constantly to make sure that you are not holding your image. So it's really like this. I mean, I'm a dancer right now giving a class in Berlin about this work. And he sent me an SMS today. He said, I just made with them today falling 2 hours long. Just fall, just fall, just fall, just fall. And he said, it's amazing to feel. He wrote that emotionally what happens by the giving up. Somehow. At the beginning, you fall, but you still control. And after a while, you feel you just fall, and you have no possibilities anymore to think about how do I look like, what I hold, etc. You can try it already if you are standing and you push a colleague. The person is going to do immediately the resistance. You hold on your vertical. Immediately. And it's hard to be able to fall that you let go. That you let go and you're falling, falling, falling. And this is constantly falling. So your walking is a fall, as if there is no end in what you are doing. So you never hold. It's not your head who is walking anymore and anticipating with the eyes. It's your feet which are walking. It's your body which is going. And this you catch through the relation to the surface. So the practice for the dancers to go there is when they are on the floor, is how to stand up without using your eyes. Because when you stand up, and I will tell you, no stand ups, you are going to stand up, and after a while, up, you bring the head, and the head brings the rest of the body up. You understand what I mean? how to go down, to stand up, and that the standing up, the movement of the head going up, is just a prolongation of your spine. And the head is something which is on your spine, but not the eyes are going to organize you in the space, but the pure organization of your skeleton. And this takes time to get this release in your gaze, that you come from a kind of controlled gaze to a more passive gaze, which makes that you can still look, but you're not controlling. The difference between this or this. So I can still see you, but I'm open here. And this gives a completely different experience of the space around and now your relation to your own body. That you are not an image anymore. I mean, I speak Lana in the ideal case. The dancer is all the time fighting with this on stage. And the fight, the work, the questioning, the trying to get that's the piece. Because you cannot suddenly completely get rid of your actually subjectivation system. It's just a game.
Change of experience for the performer, no? But is it for the audience when the audience see a performance that is kind of in this experience where he's performing inside this? Is the experience of me as an audience also in this awareness of a space and a horizontality, or is it just like just another interesting vertical image to look at?
I would say it splits the audience very extremely. Some people who enters it and others who don't and refuse it. So you have really extreme reactions on this. And some people, they will not speak about floor depth, but some people will just say, oh, I wanted to stand up and be with them. So it means that they felt already part of it. This I hear a lot from dancers. Then they look at the colleague dancing and they say, just wanted to stand up and go with them. It was as if I could enter the space. So they feel that the space is not stopping at the front, but actually they are in the space. You have different way to formulate it, but there are some people who really don't enter it. And I can understand too, I mean, first because they don't want to look at it, because you have a problem of watching suddenly. If you expect with your gaze as audience to look at pictures, you have a problem because you don't get these pictures anymore. So sometimes you have the situation that the show started already since 15 minutes, and you have people who are asking, when does it start? Because they look and you see their face, and their gaze doesn't know where to catch. So they are just looking, 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 and nothing happens for them. And others are really like... So you have really, it separates really extremely from the experience. But there is a way, and this is what I develop more and more through the pieces, to make the audience see how to look at it. So it demands that the performer is actually showing the audience that he can still watch. Because you identify as audience all the time with the body that you look at. Not just in a traditional psychological way, but from an empathical way. So if you show a body who has not at all any more the relation to the gaze within the space but is a bit blind, then the audience doesn't know what to look at. If you show a body who is able to look, so I will be there, I could still stay with you, but I can look at you and coming back to you. So I'm having actually at the same time a game with my head where it's positioned, but my eyes can still move. So you see actually that I can still look. Mm-hmm. And this helps the audience to look. Because suddenly they are looking at it, able to see, yes, my eyes are still functioning. You understand? But this double gaze, I would call it, this double way here to look away, I'm still with you here. And here I can look and I come back to you. This is tough at the beginning to catch. We are not used to that. I was talking with a psychoanalyst about this, not for my own session, but I was talking about theater with him, and I was showing him this, and he was like, wow, this must be tough to get. but it demands to have a relation to yourself with this distance, that you know actually that you are not just one package. You are a gaze, you are somebody which is watching you, and here I can still feel you, but I'm there at the same time. So it demands a certain distance from yourself to do this. And that's a game to practice this. I think the performer who like to work with me is people who like to experience with their own bodies things. But it's what makes performance interesting. To experiment, to search, and not just... I would say what is lacking today. We don't experience with the body anymore. Yeah, if I'm a bit extreme, I would say that it stopped with the... More like I exaggerate now, but the last really forms which came as a proposition of vision of the body, you can say Cunningham, Trisha Brown, Forsyth maybe, but it's a bit more neoclassic already. Makes you act somehow, the first pieces of Mech, you really try to open a new concept of the body relating to the memories and the picture inside and the virtuality of the world. So yes, but now many pieces that we see in dance or in theater, the body is not really defined. You don't really know what happens with this body. What are the rules of this body? Okay, let's say ballet. Okay, ballet has a clear system. It's a concrete body construction, the ballet. But what do we propose today from a body construction? You can say, no, we don't want all this ideology, but we cannot be out of an ideology. So we are in an ideology from the body that we have, but we don't know what it is.
I didn't understand, like, the thing you did, the double gaze there.
Yeah.
How that differs from the double gaze that you talked about in the beginning, from that I'm talking to you, but I'm having you look at
me. I'm here, but I'm doing this, but I'm not still with the person. Here I still have somehow a wall with the colleague.
Okay.
That's the difference. And here, I'm as much here, and if I turn here, I'm still there. It's still open here.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a wall. So it makes, I feel how I'm open to this direction, this direction, this direction, this direction. You are open actually in all the directions at the same time. Mm-hmm. And this is really overwhelming when it's there. You feel like in water. You feel suddenly like in a volume, like in you feel really concrete the air. You feel suddenly the wind. When you move your hand, you feel all the air on your surface. And it's not empty actually here. There is a lot of molecules moving, but you have the impression it's empty, but it's full of air here.
I just wanted to ask, the traditional theatres that you're talking about, are you in reference to Western traditional theatres?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, completely. But there is some interesting, I mean, it's a chapter I want to open for the next years, more in relation to other culture, the relation to the floor. For example, in African dance, the relation to the floor is completely different.
Yes.
That is, and I started to watch a lot of video and a lot of anthropological work on this. I'm still surprised at the head.
Mm-hmm.
It's still from here. But this I need still to it's a field I want to open. I would like actually to open all the question of the post-colonialism, which is very mode right now, but in the white European person himself.
Okay.
And not by inviting performances from it, which is nice too, but showing it as if we need to look at it in order to come back to our own origin or whatever. And more to see where is this question of the colonialism in us ourselves and not outside.
It could also be a construct of how society is Western society has programmed movement.
Yes.
And edited.
Exactly.
And that also probably has overflown into theatre all the time.
Yeah.
Also with African theatre and African dance, there is the structures and the buildings that have been established because of colonialism.
Yeah.
But it's not present as it is within the European
No, and if you look at the origin, for example, of dance, of tribal dances, they are not frontal.
Mm.
It's circle. Most of the time, it's in a circle, and there is no specific direction where they are doing the action. It's not even a show. It's something else. It it's not a show, it's a reality. It's more open maybe to the sky or to the floor, so it doesn't have this front. But this is something I want to open for the next years, to try to go deeper. Because there's something interesting there in relation to the floor, how it brings us back in relation to cultures which were longer, closer to the floor.
There's two observations that I want to tell about. For example, barefoot running, again, especially African, like a way of running really fast through the storm. It's not about pulling the earth, but it's about throwing the earth.
Mm.
The muscle system is absolutely differs. And also, other thing, abdominal body, when, let's say, they move their bodies in a way that your lungs and the diaphragm system actually inhales and exhales itself, so you don't need to kind of put it in a cage and then make it in a form that you're inhaling and exhaling within your own.
But it happens, it's more a kind of organic breathing,
yeah.
The body itself, yeah.
Also, two more things, the horizontal awareness of the whole that you were talking about, does it offer kind of certain forms of gifted immersive spectatorship?
Yes. Yeah, because for example, now if I would make here, if I would show you a little solo or pas de deux of two dancers there, and they will use the floor, the dancers will not, they will use the wall in the back. So you would be in the same space as them. They are not creating through their body the space they are dancing in. If you take the Laban system, for example, for those who know a little bit, it's clearly a limited construction of the space through the head.
Yeah.
So you have the kinesphere, you have all this relation, you have the plan here, you have the end down.
Yeah.
But it's called close the space there. So Forsyth did it that he put the center of the Laban at the end here. He goes away from it. So they are still dancing here with this center there. But it's still from the head that they imagine it. Here you say that the space that you have is reduced on the surface. You don't construct any other system than the surface that you have. So the limitation of this surface, the space I'm dancing in now, is the wall, more or less. If there is a window, it's a bit more complex. It goes further. But, and then you feel that we are sitting now on the same surface I'm moving, dancing. So it includes you. And that's the emotional challenge for the performer, because without this wall, when they are dancing here, they feel you completely. It's as if actually they are dancing with you. So your sitting is part of the actual action of them. Because they don't have a kind of space here limited that they could move on and look at each other, and they look at you, but you are far away. You are in it, so the little reaction, the little bore, the little excitement, everything influences them a lot. So it demands to be amazing quiet. It's a bit like a musician would play, a kind of distance from yourself that you let things come in and out.
It's a constant fall, then standing up. We are kind of taking away this orbicular dominant thing that the gaze always occupies in the primary. Let's take, we are taking it away, and then what we have, you said, kind of skeleton that we're focusing on the whole body skeleton. So I think there is a huge role of the ear in there, because the preciseness of the ear is 1,000 times more than the eye,
this
height itself. We can just close our eyes and then distinguish the thing in the far meters away that even, you know, the fly, you can distinguish in a millimetric. Precise. I guess I heard some experiments in the total darkness. When you dance in the total darkness, you understand it very well.
Yeah, but I know this from dancers. There is a typical improvisation exercise, which they call actually, I don't like the name, but it's called, what's the name of it? Not real movement, but authentic movement. And it's based on dancing with closing the eyes. So So it's supposed then suddenly you forget the question of what you look like, and you are just moving in it. First of all, you might have a lot of pictures in you, so it doesn't make you getting rid of the visuality by closing the eyes. But the ears is an interesting point, because of feeling this surface and losing this, you open these eyes. So you feel really, or you get information from your ears. So it has an influence. I started actually by searching on this with the dancers, talking to them a lot about hearing. So open your ears, less than the eyes. The problem is that if I change it a bit, the way to approach it, because it makes them oversensitive from just here, and it almost makes them blind. That suddenly they were just hearing, and it's so much information that you get through the ears. And then we had musicians playing Bach to it, and they were hearing, it was too much. It was really as if it was coming in, and they were like, I mean, you have dancers suddenly starting to cry just when they hear Bach, because it's touching them so much. And they don't even dance. And I think the interesting point is not to get rid of, it was really impressive. It's not to get rid of the eyes, it's to get a balance. That you the priority of the eyes in relation to the ears, it's getting an equality in it, and not this dominating, and this somehow. But I would say it's more interesting for me to consider the hearing as a consequence of these questions, and then it comes in the game as a goal of this question, because then it limits me again on a certain perspective. And it's neglecting the fact that we are all actually children from Kant and all this Western construction of the world, and this we cannot throw away. So we have to think from there. And it's nice too. I still like to look at beautiful paintings. So I don't want to be blind there, even if it opens other possibilities. But just about the floor, if you close your eyes, and you can do it tonight at home if you want, be careful that you don't have any dangerous things around. You close your eyes and you walk a little bit. You're going to feel how fast your feet are completely changing their perception in order to give you a way to walk. And you are going to start to feel the continuity of the floor, because you will have to test with your feet if the floor is still flat, if the floor is still going. So suddenly you realize the surface is a continuous thing we are on. And when you open your eyes after, and you try to still feel the relation to the feet on the floor. When you open your eyes, you don't suddenly come back here. You say, okay, I stay down in my feet. I open my eyes, I still feel my feet. And you look at the floor, and you're going to feel suddenly your body starts to fall automatically. And this fall is amazing to experience, because then you are a bit like, by moving an arm, moving another one, you are moving the head. All this makes that you organize your own balance in the space. Dancing is nothing more than this. What is ballet? Ballet normally is all to use all the balance of the and the position you put all your arms, etc. The point is that ballet is mastering it. Ballet is using the artificial vertical that you put to stand on, face, gaze, and you show the thing. So you still use somehow the anatomy of the body, but the priority is the verticality. And what you show as a picture here, you organize it, but you don't take care of what you are showing as a picture. The picture suddenly appears, because you come in a moment when you are turning, your arm is turning in a certain position, you stop, and you can come close to something that you recognize as audience. Oh, it's beautiful this moment, but it's away. So it's more like caressing all the time some potential pictures that you can recognize, but it's not showing it. You are never grabbing the thing. So once again, it's a kind of relation to it, which makes that you are not saying look, but you say more be with, share with. And so it's almost as if we discover together the potential picture. When the dancer feels suddenly his arm is going like this, he has the possibility suddenly to this, and and he will show it more to you, tack isolation of the arms, or to come to this moment to feel the moment he could go there. He doesn't go, he goes away. But it triggers already your gaze to see it, but it disappears. And this game is, sexism. Yeah, because you play, you know, it's like playing with the looking, and it brings you back in the awareness, actually. What do I show? What is it about? Play with the expectation, but I'm not deciding alone to be there. It's my weight, and if I go further with my arm, I'm falling. If I don't want to fall, I have to bring this foot further. If not, I fall, or this arm to bring it to compensate. So you are all the time playing with the organization around. Mm. You understand? Mm. So I can decide to say, I want to go there, but I cannot just do this and go. I have to ask my body, how can I go there? And then you go. So it's all the time going through the body and the organization in the space. And through the surface, because the body, we stood up from the surface, is a consequence of the horizontality. So all the movement that you do is what I call our horizontal. Remain horizontal. And you see, by practicing it 3 years, it changed completely your relation to your spine and how you look to your neck. And so at the beginning when you practice it, I mean the people here practice it a little bit, can make some pain at the beginning because you use differently the body. So the lower back, that normally by using the eyes, the lower back is here, you have a kind of cambré all the time in this position. By holding the vertical with the eye, clack, it holds every time here. When you look at a dancer, he's holding his vertical, you see the moment when clack, here. And here it's the contrary, you have to release this that you can fall. If I hold my lower back, I don't fall. Blocks. So already this action to release here in order to be able to go, that demands a lot of shift in your organization of the body. And depth. Suddenly as audience, if I'm standing as audience here, and I look, I feel the depth. I feel the distance suddenly towards another one. Because if I look at you from the floor, I feel the back of you. So my body coming close to you, feels suddenly when I'm coming here, the potential collision with you. Mm. That if I would go further, our bodies do, pop. And if I come in a normal way, I stop here, no collision. There is clearly a separation here. It's almost telling me to stop. Because here we meet off the face. So a subject meets another subject, there is a kind of distance where we know to stop. If I connect again back with the surface, nobody wants to go further. And then it will make a collision with you. It makes beautiful dance. I did a piece which is called Chaos, and you see really the bodies adjust all the time in collisions, like bubbles in water. All the time touching, and how it orients your body new.
But then it's changing also the relation to anticipation. You were mentioning at the beginning that sight is
you can see, for example, if I come here and I would go to you, I see I would fall, I can ask my body not to fall, so I go back. But I can see that you will go, but I cannot anticipate it. I have to organize my body that I'm not going to the accident with you. Mm. You understand the difference? If I come and I fall here and I connect again to your face and I do this, this is a decision. The other one, if I go but and I ask my body for my weight, how can I go back? It's I play with the organization of my weight, then I go in another direction. So I can decide, but it's a negotiation with my body how it's organized.
For me, it feels
a lot
like that you're doing this. That it's like if you're looking into his eyes, you're very much in the head and become like a very intellectual thing or like an intelligent thing that all the focus goes there, and when you do the other thing that is like that is that you can just body somehow.
Yeah.
And it's also for me it feels like this taking off the head kind of
Yeah, but you can see I have a head.
Yeah. But then it's like and it's that
but
it's
not
as
if I'm like
almost closing up to not being
a
conscious
yes. And it's the game with this, which makes that you feel, now if I'm more in relation with you through down, I still see you. And there's still something in me which can, but I stay in the body.
Yeah.
The gaze is not taking over and make the head out of this. Make the experience. Put yourself on the floor and ask somebody to stand up. You will see the beginning is still okay, and very fast the head does. It's almost like you don't know how to stand up without using your head at the beginning. You are really, you're on the floor and you're like, you're gonna forget the head. And it's amazing when you just connect to the body, to the floor, actually the principles in order to move after, but it goes a bit more in details, is that you feel that each movement is a falling first before it goes up. It's like a tennis ball. Tennis ball goes down, it goes up as a reaction. So the floor is having an action on the ball when you fall. It's the same. It's when you are lying, you feel on the floor is actually moving you up. And when you have this, you feel suddenly it's really like, you know, the body, like from almost no effort, is being moved up in the vertical. So the vertical is a result of this organization of the body up, and not a result of the eyes. And that makes another quality of the verticality. So your body is in relation to the vertical, but it's not fixed on the vertical. I make the difference by calling this vertical of the eyes a transcendental vertical, because it's related to a kind of belief in a certain philosophical subject, or a physical vertical, which is more the vertical of the gravity. It's more, you could see, a pure question of organizing the body up. And at the beginning, when you come to this place, you see they are searching for the balance without using the eyes. And if you use the eyes, immediately, tack, I find it, but I'm stuck on it. I cannot fall from this one. I have to release the eyes, release this, and I can fall from it. You understand the game? So you can still be vertical there. It's not as if we are like this all the time.
But it also can give a contemporaneity to the action when it happens.
Yeah.
Like if you're walking and you decide to stop, you're stopping before actually stopping, no?
Yeah.
You make the decision is not a result of
what
of
do you
an
mean?
Action.
We say if I use the eyes or if I use the
if you use the eyes.
Yes. The eyes anticipate all the time. It's a difference if you walk and you walk because your eyes are walking, so you are already following your eyes, or if it's the body which is walking to a place. And then the eyes are just looking, but the body is walking. Because of this, you have the chance as audience to see a pure walking, independently of the goal. The goal is not to show, it's not to go from A to B. So this is not B which is interesting, it's all the way. And you don't know when you're going to stop. Oh, I stop here. No, I go further. So as audience, it opens you an amazing relation to the moment. And you feel yourself by doing it, you don't know where you're going to stop. This little walk I was doing here, it's really work to begin for the dancer to catch. They are scared. They start to walk and they're like, First, the breathing change is completely true, what you said. Dancer I work very long with, can do it very well now. He says it's a breathing act, his dance. It's like it shifts my legs, he say. And he says it's a bit painful in the ribs because it's happening like rib cage, it's too small for it. He said he needs to find space to get the volume for it. And actually, finally, to see a dance which has no goal. It's just the moment. You don't have this kind of teleological question, because of this you do it, it happens. Or maybe the goal is just to feel this, to be with, to experience this. But indeed you can still organize. So interesting question I will have now for the next pieces is to choreograph more and more precise, that you keep this quality even if you know exactly the movement that you're going to.
I'm curious when you talk about especially this thing of the goal, but the whole ideas that you're talking about, how you
to talk about play. Yeah. I said it and I didn't want to talk about that. No, I can, of course. It's actually from the body to be the same perspective. But of course, I cannot go so far with actors, not so much because they will not be able to do it, it's a question of time. When I have 8 weeks a national theater to make a piece, I cannot open this too deeply.
But I'm actually asking because you're so concerned with this, so
yeah.
I'm wondering how this concern, how
yeah.
this orientation, this research affects your choices of text, for instance, or way of working.
Yeah, the I think it's to understand with the text is what that I call it, but how when you are speaking a text, how a text is actually sculpturing the body more than you decide to become it. So for example, for an actor, I would say you speak the text, and the text is like a boomerang coming back to you and telling you more or less by hearing the text. Just you speak, you hear, and it tells you. Beautiful example of Sarah Kane, Psychosis, this long passage when she says, I'm sad, I'm fat, I don't like my hips, etc. I did this as solo in Schauspielhaus Hamburg, and the actress is like, oh, how can I feel all this? I mean, it's a lot. I'm happy, I'm sad, I want to die. I mean, it's. I said, just say it, but hear it. And then by talking and hearing, the text tells you what should happen. So you have here a kind of, not a goal to be sad because it says sad. You speak the text, and the text is having an influence on your body, on you, and gives you somehow the costume that you have to wear, or it gives you almost the game that you have to play. You can refuse it. What I did with Nora of Ibsen in National Theatre, all what Nora has to say, I'm sad, I want to scream, blah, blah, blah. And I was, we're not going to show a woman like this today. So, but the actress was all the time in relation to it. So she was standing and suddenly she was saying, oh, I'm so sad. But you saw her even thinking. So you saw all the time her looking at the man, because it's a piece with a lot of men on her, you know. And all the men looking and playing. Okay, they need now me a bit sad. Oh. So you saw her actually playing with Ibsen, more or less, what Ibsen demands to this woman to do. And what he wants to see, but not against, but just aware of what is being asked to me.
So
I don't know if I answered a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. But and then is this experiencing of the text.
What you're saying now, does that mean sort of being aware as you're playing this old text, how it reverberates today in a way?
Yes, but I would say how it. I mean, a text like Ibsen is maybe not. It's a good example, more in terms of feminism or political, more on a gender perspective, or something like this. But if you take a text like Büchner or like Heiner Müller, which is much more literature, complex text, very poetical. What I'm interested in is by why the actor is talking the text, how it vibrates in him or in her. And from this you discover the character. So it means that if I would do this piece with you or with you, if I would, it would be a completely different character coming out, and from what I feel to in the text, but by letting you speak the text, I would search a place where you are touched by the text. But I would never tell an actor, for me, the character is like this. I did Don Juan with a student in Bern 2 months ago, and the student was supposed to play Don Juan, so it's more like studies of the scene studies. And it said you have to work with this student on this role. The teacher decided he has to be Don Juan. And when you look at the guy at the beginning, you're like, oh, that should be Don Juan, okay. Not so much how he looks like, but more the personality and the way he talks, etc. And you're like, very complex text. So you let him, yeah, I mean, it's complex, you have to think a lot as an actor. So I let him speak a lot of the text and just telling to tell him, no, you don't feel. But I never told him, Don Juan is like that. It will kill him, because we are not at all of the same way to understand this text. But he found a place, or it happened suddenly, that the text touched him. from this place, the way he took the text, you have the impression that he understands every sentence. And it's not just an impression. In the moment, he says, it speaks out of me. So it's not me who is interpreting the text. He said, I have a place suddenly where I have a resonance with the text. I have my own momentum with the text, my own rhythm. I feel exactly now I speak, now I stop, now I go further. And it makes the text suddenly amazing, clear in the room. But it was his Don Juan. And when I look at it, I discover the Don Juan I would like to see, but on his way. But I never did this with any actors, to tell them. And when I tried earlier, maybe it's the result is never good for me, according to what I searched for. But it demands that you bring a person to be touched by what the person does. It demands that you look for a personal place where the actor, in speaking of the text, is putting himself or herself in the game. And this, many times, actors will hide behind a character. They would say, what the character wants, what the character is, and I say, no, not what the character wants, it's what do you want? It doesn't mean that we don't do a character, that it's you who is speaking the text, not the character. You understand the difference? And this, to find this place where an actor is touched by a text, and it makes him fragile, it makes him exposed, but he's becoming very personal. It's not easy. Because it's something that an actor doesn't offer to a director the first day. It's a lot of patience and trust. And there's a moment, I remember working with Fabian Inrichs on Iphigenie. Big German text, Goethe, Iphigenie for the German, it's a big reference. And I did Iphigenie with a man, Fabian Inrichs, very famous German actor. And I worked with him a lot on this way. He was so, he felt so exposed. We were in the rehearsing room, but so exposed, the big monologue of Iphigenie at the end, very famous when Iphigenie speaks of all the ancestors and all the catastrophe which happened in the family. And he could not speak in front of me. He didn't want to see any assistants, any trainees, etc. And you know, in Germany, I mean, you have a director and you have 16 assistants and 10 trainees, so it's a huge team. Not like in Norway, everybody is equal. And we had to put every assistant, everybody out. He said, I just want to be with you alone. And he could not the first day. He was really practicing the text with open doors out and just talking like this text. But he could not feel that he could be in front of me at the beginning, but by trying to search for this place. And he was coming more and more every day, one after day, closer in the room until the end. So it's really a question of exposure. So it's not Iphigenie is like this and I do that. It happens too by great actors when they work with a character that they bring something personal. It's actually by all great actors the fact. But many actors who talk about characters, figure, whatever you want to call it. That's why I'm pretty bored in this kind of theater very fast, because I see a kind of schema. Like they think it should be, or like they think we want to see it. You see it very clearly when an actor just plays what he thinks actually other people think, and but you don't see the actor exposed. He comes on stage to be exposed. And if you don't match this... So at the beginning, working with actors, I was not working with them on the floor, not the, all this horizontal question, but I was working with them on the fact to feel the exposure of the eyes. So I would tell them in the rehearsing room just to stand at the beginning and to show me that I look at them. It's a very nice exercise to do with somebody standing and make me feel that I look at you. It's not easy to find.
What do you mean, make?
You as audience, that you can, when you look at me, you feel, oh, I look at you.
Okay.
So it means that the actor is integrating public, the fact that he is watched. If not, the talent of an actor normally is to make you feel that you are not there. That's the what acting is. He says, hello, as if you are not here. that's what he learns. But then I was asking him already, no, I want to see that you know I'm here. But not because you are doing ha ha ha, which is another way to put you. you out. It's a typical way to act, pseudo-direct, you know, very direct here, I can talk to the people, I look at them. But and this way of showing, it was bringing them in relation to me. And it brought them in a place of fragility, which was very interesting for the text. Because then speaking the text was really shared. And I think I told this already, this example to students here, but suddenly speaking a text is really a process. It's almost a process of experiencing this. And this Fabian I was talking about in Munich with Iphigenie, one day he was feeling that the way he was speaking the text was not right, how he started, and it was the big stage in Munich, and so it's something. And stopped after 3-4 lines, and said, audience, I have to start again. And he went out, and he came back, and he started again. The audience was like under shock. Just this act was for them much more than if he was putting the clothes down, masturbating, whatever. Today people can take everything, so which I understand, we went through everything. But he was just standing, looking at the audience and saying, I have to start again. And you saw him going out. And Iphigenie, Munich, all these abonnement people down in the first row and with the reclam heft text to compare what he says and what is in the yeah, that's German theater. I mean, in terms of classical pieces, in certain places, at Volksbühne they don't do it, but in Berlin, but in Münchner Kammerspiel, in Munich, yes. And they talk about it. They look the favorite verse. How does he speak this verse that I love so much? It has a beauty too. I love it. If you know how to play with this and to question, because you really see our relation to culture. If it's not blocking, but it has, it's touching too. You see this. But speaking is an act too of you let the text direct you. And the text is a beautiful guide. If you speak it in a way that you hear it, I think the difficulty is to hear a text. And of course, in order to hear a text, the rhythm helps. The structure helps, but this demands already literature. If you have a well-done play, working for theater normally, this kind of work is not so easy because the piece doesn't hold it and it doesn't carry you. Or it's becoming really fast, like a farce. Or it destroys the text immediately. It shows that it doesn't give anything. But I don't like it when you use the text to do whatever. It's nice when you feel it's a meeting with the text, and this meeting, this dialogue with the text makes the piece. So it's never becoming, I swallow the text, I'm becoming the character, and my character speaks now like this. No, it's you who speak this text in this moment. It can become a character, nothing against it. But the character is just a kind of part of this bigger question. And after, when it works well, you have an evening where you see suddenly a character, very traditional theater, and suddenly it's very far from this. So you have like the text and the speaker of the text. They meet, they separate very far. The actor is a bit lost, the speaker of the text, but it doesn't catch. Suddenly catch a lot. So you have a moment, 10 minutes, everybody's like, suddenly you're a bit lost. It's like going down, because it's impossible for an actor to be 1.5 hours, 2 hours, with such a focus and to hear everything what he says. You get crazy. So it's to accept actually that it's impossible mission. It's a kind of ideal, but you work with wanting to reach even more. I remember this Fabian about Iphigenie saying, last night this moment was completely out, tonight I work on it better. And then he had this evening super, this moment, and he said, for this I lost the one after. So you are all the time in this, so you are in a situation that you are never mastering. I come back to the question of the dance, you are all the time a bit falling, because you cannot, we are just human beings, we don't reach this perfection of perceiving, but I like that it's still a goal, that it's still an ideal. It's like in dance, an arabesque is never good enough. So you just compare the arabesque that you look at for those who go to ballet in relation to the ideal arabesque that you have in your imagination that you saw one time 20 years ago from the amazing dancer, and you see other dancers all the time trying on to jump even higher or to turn even more, not just 6 pirouettes, 7, 8, I'm going to try now 8.5. And here it's a bit the same with this, but it brings you in relation to, it brings you actually in a modest situation towards a goal that you know is not reachable.
But do you think that text affects the body as well?
Yeah, definitely.
And if it does, is it, do you allow it to work through the body?
Yes.
Or do you still need to stand still to listen to it? Because listening can also be the body reacting.
Yeah, but it's a mix. You can if you are speaking the text affects you back. Who is speaking after is different than who was speaking at the beginning.
Okay.
So you have a kind of process, and after a while you don't know anymore what is first.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't know when you speak, is it the text who is going to tell me, or is it a consequence of who I am now?
Mm-hmm.
This text and this dialogue is. Very nice. But you have to find the balance that you are not overwhelmed by the text. Because if you go too far within it, you lose completely this position of reflection. So that's why I would tell an actor, if an actor could be touched by a text and he hear the maximum of his emotionality, he has to stop every time a bit before. Never go to the top. Or you decide, nice explosion, that's it, it's done. But it's every time nice to see this. Control, not control. Control, not control.
But doesn't this now go back to the beginning of you saying that traditional theatre is reverse of control, and how we have had to, or recent societies had to control their bodies, and so now you're saying exercise a bit of control, but now aren't we saying yes, we want to experiment more without the control, but at the same time let us stay within the frames of control.
Yeah, to give an example with dance, it would be maybe more clear, but it's the same. Is that I would say a dancer, stay on the position that you are not going to fall fully.
Mm.
So you play with the fall, but it's, I mean, you can fall. I don't have any problem when I mean, they fall a lot if they fall on the floor, but it's not the goal. And here I would say it's the same for the actor. So it's not a control in order to master, but it's to keep the position that you are going to be able to go further. You know, it's like Deleuze said about the alcoholic, I love it. He said the real alcoholic person just drink until the last glass, but he stops just before that it's catastrophic because he wants to drink again tomorrow. If not, he goes to the hospital, it's over. And it's what Deleuze called this the principle of the N-1, that he said you drink until the last glass minus the glass which will actually destroy you, because tomorrow you want to drink. And it's a bit this, you stop before the accident because you want to continue. So that's the control I took about. If I go here over the top, what actors love to do, screaming suddenly like, ugh. We are like, okay, and now it's done, thank you. I don't know the name of English, of German, they call it Ausbruch. And they learn it's cool, Ausbrüche. You hear it from actors in a traditional, more traditional way to learn. They say, oh, today we worked on no Ausbrüche with my teacher. How I come to a place where I really explode.
Yeah, I was wondering when you say this about the text all the way affecting how you.
Yes.
That this is a process. How do you generate pauses and like the action you say in your next line? Who's doing that? Who is deciding?
You.
Yeah, but
it's a bit like when you play music. When you play music and you are playing, for example, then a phrase which comes to an end of a melody. If you play good music, it gives you a certain state when you come down. And here you have, for example, then a silence, and then another melody starts, another phrase. But this
so is
what
it
happens.
The silence that
this influences this, of course. Yes, it's a little. You hear, it tells you what to do the next. But when you play music, you are also now divided between hearing and doing. You have to hear when you play music to know how to play. And I would say it's a bit the same with the speaker, that he to hear, it tells him where he can go with the text. And for those who play music, they know that. you are happy when you reach this state that you feel, wow, amazing dialogue. You can control, but you are completely out of yourself. You don't know who is playing. What you had with last week, when suddenly you are making the space, you go and it happens to itself.
Yeah, but it, I don't feel that it does. It's like I'm always deciding now to do something. But this is like to aim at the silence and the space affecting you to do this.
But you can still decide not to do it. You are not a zombie, you're just doing the things. But you hear, I have this possibility. And I would say that you never have just one. You have many different possibilities.
Mm.
But it tells you what not. You try something, you think, I cannot go. That's, for example, too, when I was looking at the work of Frederick today, you see very nice how they move in the space, and you see a moment, the way of going from one chair to the other one, you're like, no, that's not working. In relation to the logic which appears in the room.
What do you think how the this that the text kind of shapes the actor, but how does it relates to the relate to the way the audience looks at the actor? Because just from experience, it's always like this: when someone starts speaking, you look at the person. And that also makes it very difficult to start speaking. Like, you can enter a room, but then to actually start speaking in front of people is a much more difficult act.
I would say, which is nice, I mean, what I like, what I enjoy, as watcher, I'm watcher too, by looking, first of all, people who like my theater, they say, we hear a text amazingly, they would say. But we could not hear this text if we just close the eyes during the show and we say, oh, we hear the text, we don't hear anything anymore. We need to see this body in order to hear the text, like we hear it. So it's as if you have an amazing clarity of the text and how the text actually structures, manipulates, organizes the body. And how a text influences you as audience for what you look at. There's a way to say, I'm sad, but even if you are not playing sad at all, you see suddenly the person is sad.
Mm-hmm.
So the text actually is directing to performativity, pure what I'm talking about. But it's to put you in relation of language manipulates. It's a difference then how our relation with body is, how we are actually constructed by the signifiers. I mean, from the words, or language functions. Another way to say it, maybe, is the language that you speak is not yours.
Mm-hmm.
It's what the papa and mama gave you, and you took it from them.
Mm-hmm.
So you have more or less in your language all the intonation, rhythm, if I put it very simple now, from your mom, and you have the grammatic of papa. And you believe in Lacan. But and this is not yours. You did something with it, and I like to see an actor on stage where he shows that there is the text, the written text doesn't belong to him,
mm-hmm.
something foreign. But you can come in relation to it that it constructs to you, or you refuse this construction through the words.
Mm-hmm.
So it puts you in a relation to the power of language and how a text affects you. An author, it is interesting to see then when you come to this relation with author like Heiner Müller. When you speak Heiner Müller as actor and you take it seriously, the text, you don't know where to bring it. You have a problem. So it obliges the actor to change his way of body to find a way how to speak it. And you see suddenly another body appearing through the text because the text demands this body in order to be spoken. If you don't decide as actor, I don't care, I speak here, 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 here. But the text is written on a way that there is no moment to speak. It's a flow.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? I don't know if I answered a bit.
Yeah, I understand.
You need to enjoy as audience to see two separate things, a body and a language, and also
sometimes it matches, sometimes not. And if you like this game as audience, then you are fine.
Yeah. It was more this, like wondering how this, with speaking the text, can come together with the aim of not having the audience having a frontal view on the actor.
I mean, speaking is related, because when you speak the text on this way, it's not about how you look like, what image you give, it's more about the sharing of the hearing experience. So hearing actually is round. You don't hear, but you speak in one direction. You just speak in the direction of the eyes, but you hear.
Yeah.
So you can think you speak in another direction, but I think what you share with the audience in more in speaking text is the what you take away from the frontal view that you hear. And the actor is the one who gives this text to be heard. Yes?
Yeah.
Sorry, I have to sometimes
no,
go
no,
around. Maybe an actor is saying to an audience, here. And not an actor is saying, watch. But more, here. That would be maybe... yes, I would say for me that's about this, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And from hearing, even if the actor is not speaking, if you would be mute, but if you would just say, hear the silence, you would see something different.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the nature. The nature doesn't tell you when you look at the landscape, look at me. But you look. The tree doesn't say look.
Traditional theater space, and how you found that also very interesting to play with this turning the vertical or using horizontal in that. You also came a little bit in later, but could you go more into that? Like, why is that an interesting thing for you? What is it that's interesting about doing it in, like, let's say, like a very traditional singing stage? How would you
Because it questions actually then the on a very you can see the traditional proscenium stage as the place of power, where the with parallel to the construction of the subject, so depending of the countries, the theater tradition is different. So you have this classical time in France, more or less in the 17th century, in Germany in the 18th century, where suddenly the theater is becoming a place to show how we have to be, and how we present the wide thinking subject from a certain perspective. And to keep this architecture with all the directions gives to the body, and in it to make people experience another body. It's for me like showing the, or making the powerful controlled in terms of subject body to be questioned.
So it's also bringing out of like the social functions in the theater at this time frame, like that.
The political,
yeah.
The political function is really a picture. I mean, Schiller, the German author for the theater, and who created the base of the German dramaturgy, etc., says it, the stage is a place to look at how to be, and it should educate the people how to behave. So it's really, it was the function of the theater, and it's not so far away when you would joke now with the dramaturge of the National Theater, wherever, and look at the program F, they all the time make the moral to the people. Making morality. The people saying, oh, this piece is good because today, we should show people without jobs. We know how to be. It's more or less what the theater is saying all the time. And here you show suddenly a place of, no, we don't know, we are not sure about our image. So we don't put the clarity of how it should be. But there is something that we have a weight, we have a body, and we are part of the world.
But is it also like about this anticipation or expectation in the audience, that when they go to a theater looking like this, the stage looking like that?
Yes, it plays with an expectation, but the goal is that it opens them to see suddenly, how is it working on me normally in this place? How does it manipulate me? I mean, how many people who go to theater really realize how much architecture in theater manipulates them? I mean, I would say if you have 1% of them, it would be good. How many people realize of the portal, how it's built, if it's round, if it's like this, of the curves of the audience is all this, or the stairs, the Paris Opera, the stairs is already manipulating your body. All the direction all the of the stairs is there to prepare you and to make you feel in a certain way before you. So that's for me about that. It's all about this before the piece started on stage. You have another piece which already started when you entered the theater. It's all this organization of your gaze is different if you look at the piece in on the big stage, National Theatre, or in Malazan, or in Amphi, because of the space there. The round thing in amphitheater that you have in the back, which is a problem for all the directors, we don't know how to deal with this weird round form there at the wall, is having a huge influence on what you see. And people don't realize this, that the world reconstructed. It's not just a space where we go to sit and look, it's thought. And there is a beautiful book from André, Ulrike Haas about in Germany, which is kind of reference about the question of the optic and the theater. I think it's called the Drama of the Watching, Das Drama des Sehens. And it's about all the contrastions seen the antique theater, how the conception of the stage and the theater was thought politically to manipulate the people in a certain way. Manipulate is a word that we use now. In that time, it would be how they were thinking, how they were. So it's really to make them feel, to feel the context in which you are. And now, and this I practiced a lot, and maybe the high peak of this, which was a huge success, my Sacré Sacre du Printemps, was just about this, using Sacre du Printemps, the piece of Stravinsky, but just dancing on a way only that people were really feeling actually how the dancers are looking at them all the time. So opening a kind of wildness in the performer, but from a white perspective, not trying to be wild as another culture. They were just touching the portal sometimes and looking at the audience, almost making them, if you want, destroy that. But we danced. And it was all the time. So and this awareness, it was for some audience unbearable because they felt that they were so superior to them. And they were not superior, they were just equal. They were just showing the audience, we know how you look at us. We know how this is making us like this or not. You know? And it's a pleasure to share suddenly a performance with actors or dancers aware where they are. It's, for me, it's just a basic question of intelligence that we share. To see a person reflecting on stage, aware, I know how you look at me, I know how I look at you, I know what we share, let's take this now together, is much better than somebody playing that is under me and is just acting for me, I mean, according to me. But in it, that the goal I search a bit now, is still then how to choreograph. So you keep this question in the room, but you propose something too in terms of a story, whatever you want. But at the same time, you have this reflection all the time. Sorry, it was before, but after you can ask. Sorry.
No, it's just regarding the architecture.
Yeah.
How do you relate to, okay, then you play in the big proscenium stage in Munich,
yeah,
and you know how like the people come there, it's quite classical and everything,
yeah,
compared to how in Berlin, Hebel am Ufer. How, because that's a completely different setting, cool bar, black box with the tribune, and yeah, but how do you relate to that? How do you incorporate that into?
I mean, you work with the performers that they are aware of these influences. We do, before every show, a kind of practice of the sitting of the audience. They go to the path that the audience is doing. They are dancing and improvising in the audience, feeling, ah, okay, here they look like this. So there is a kind of incorporating in their bodies of the, how the architecture is influencing the watcher. So they have a kind of reaction on it. They know somehow they are looked at.
But also just in the different audiences coming to the different places, because one thing is having the authority of the audience
yeah.
in a classical theater
yeah.
compared to a more contemporary
yeah.
theater.
Yeah. Yeah, but this you have to live in the moment with this.
Yeah.
You integrate it in the moment. This you cannot control directly.
No.
But you know, Fabian was saying, for him it's very different to play in Munich when he said when he was playing in front of cotton fields, which are more old people with white hair. And he was saying, yeah, Fabian is a special case, but he was like, oh, Laurence, today was really cotton fields. As you stay on stage and you see just this white. But it's a beautiful picture, you know, cotton fields. Or if you play in front of young people, but you adapt immediately. But it's not so much that you match to them. The resonance is another one, so it's another show. But it's interesting to feel that when you really have the room good in your hands as a performer, when the audience comes in, they are influenced by the atmosphere. You feel they come, and there's a silence appearing, but they don't know. Just because of the way the performers are standing. It makes already. But and it's good that you cannot control to decide how they are, and it's part of the meeting with them. But it's another show. I mean, sometimes it's nice to perform in Berlin in Hau, and you have all your contemporary friends coming, but it's a bit incestuous too, you know. Each other, they all love it. And, you know, it's so you surprise them because suddenly you change something. So some of them say, "Oh."
But then you also make conscious choices with this.
No, it's,
no.
It's just,
okay.
It's just because you want to do something a bit different, and then
yeah.
you know it's going to surprise them. But it's not a goal to surprise
no.
them. But sometimes it's nice to have more conservative public because the friction is another one. But I had it with the one piece, Tanzstück number 4, older piece, and. The contemporary scene, but he loved it. And they were all coming, running, etc. We had a queue outside, he was talking, so to make sure we're going more and more public. And I felt a bit bad about it. Not because it was love, but you felt suddenly you matched to a discourse. You matched to a way of thinking. They can use all the words they have. And I remember, so in terms of conscious, that it gave me a kind of impulse to make a piece after where I knew it's going to make a friction with them. And it was easy to do. You put a woman in a dress on stage, in a contemporary dancing. It works. It's amazing. Taught by public. How can you do this? Da, 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 da. And you are just laughing. It's but it's to show their borders too. You know, it's becoming such an ideology too. The reactions. It's exactly the same like just putting a woman in the dress. Or to say it's forbidden, because of what you hear from especially a certain gender, very emancipated corner, you're suddenly, you cannot do that. It's what you hear. And you're like, why? And the dancer was there, I like my dress. And then, and I think for me, it opened a nice discussion about how a certain scene goes in an opposition direction, which is for me as normative as the scene they want to criticize.
Mm-hmm.
It was about this, actually. But the piece was not just about that. But it matched to say, oh, are you okay with dresses? And they were like, yeah, do it. Up. A bit flottant, and when you're moving, it turns a bit. And you feel immediately the audience, some of your people, like, just because of that. So you see really the signs how they are easy to, but it's not a question of being easy, but I like to you have some taboo that you don't even understand. But it's
probably worse because you're a man, so it's not Pinabosch,
yeah, but even this scene will not go to Pinabosch. This scene I'm talking about, this gender engaged corner,
oh,
early,
they, don't like
they will
no,
not
of
go
course,
to Pinabosch.
Of course, I mean, I guess it's even worse when a man.
Yeah.
Best
yeah.
woman makes
yeah.
her dance around.
You have to play with the codes. But to play with the codes demands to search them, to know them, to look at them, you know? So it's not easy to play with the codes because you have to feel how is it manipulating us, actually. And then to ask, and knowing that we cannot find a position where we are completely against because we are all the time in too. Cannot be against. Yes, just the last thing, it's like with the Trump thing, you know, it's in Germany I'm completely surprised how everybody's like, but when you look at the program that the theaters are doing sometimes and how they are just matching with what the audience wants to see, etc., actually they are supporting this kind of way.
Mm.
But officially they are all on the left side.
Want to start, right?
Thank you guys.
Yeah.
It was nice to see you.
Show
during the I mean continuity is an important yes, I mean it's something which is continuously there, but you can, it's not an improvisation.
No.
It's important to make the difference because sometimes you say it's happening, people will say actually it's improvisation.
Mm.
No, it's you have a goal, but it's, the goal is a certain way to be which makes that you have to be in the moment.
Mm.
I like the smell.
I learned it.